invitation in his inaugural lecture as the titular chair to engage in a more political philosophy, namely one which I understand the invitation as being one that takes institutions a lot more seriously than many political philosophers have, and in particular institutions that I'm interested in are institutions of democracy. So, you know, we had a renaissance of writing about democratic theory that lasted, or it's still lasting, but still going on, that opposed people like David Esmond and Thomas Cristiano, which was both very interesting for someone who thought that democracy was under-theorized in a lot of the political philosophy literature in recent years, but also very frustrating in the sense that nobody reading and getting involved in the debate between, say, Cristiano and Esmond that dominated the literature for a number of years would have any inkling of the kind of institutional realizations that democratic societies had given to the idea of democracy, and that this was a limitation and a problem. So the project that I've been embarked on for a number of years now, that's given rise to a few publications now, is to think very seriously about the institutions of democracy, and to engage in, part of the conversation is one that I'm involved in with Leah Uppi and Jonathan White, and I take, there's a methodological, I don't know if people have seen the new book. Well, actually, of course we've seen the book. It now is realized in material form. Yeah, it exists.
I can pass it around.
And one of the things they say at the very beginning, despite disagreements that I have with them at various points, one of the things that they say at the very beginning is that it's interesting that when you think about institutions and ideas in democratic theory at the institutional level, particularly the idea of party, of partisanship, they tend to be viewed by political philosophers intuitively, without really thinking about it, as unilaterally empirical. When you talk about a party, you're not talking about an ideal, you're talking about an institution without in a sort of an animating set of ideals or principles. It's only when you get to the abstractions, the lofty abstractions, that when we talk about democracy or liberalism, that you have both a descriptive sense of democracy. Democracy will be happening tomorrow in the United States, despite the fact that it will, one of the candidates will be Donald Trump. But that doesn't mean that we do away with the idea of democracy, because we have this loftier ideal of democracy that we can measure actual existing democracies against. So I'm very much on board with one of the ideas that Jonathan and Leah defend, which is that we need to have this sort of dual aspect, normative empirical aspect, with respect to more fine-grained, institutionally located ideas of democracy, such as party, partisanship, the idea of a party platform, which is something that I've written about. They are both elections, electoral systems. They are both the bread and butter of actually existing electoral systems, but they are also animated by their own ideals, by their own rationales, which you can't just read off the guiding rationales or ideals of democracy, whatever that might be. So the project that I'm involved in is an attempt at doing a kind of a dual aspect, reclaiming the normative rationales behind the idea of party, and in particular using a certain view, a certain argument about the idea of party to get involved in a debate which we may or may not be getting involved with in the next few months in Canada to do with electoral reform. Because I think that we have to think about the ideals of partisanship and of parties and the electoral systems that they're embodied in as part of a whole. And hopefully that will become clearer in what I have to say. So that by way of prolegomenon, right? To get into the nitty-gritty of institutional ideas that are the necessary modes of realization of democratic ideals does not mean descending into the purely descriptive. There's a lot of normative argument that needs to be done at that level as well. So let me begin with some work that I've been doing on a slightly different level, but it will connect hopefully in ways that will become clear. Another one of the frustrations that I've had with democratic theory, even in the pre-Esmond and Cristiano debate, has to do with the way in which it has represented the goal that democratic debates should be geared at. For a number of years, the debates about democratic deliberation were dominated by a position which had both a sort of continental instantiation through the work of Jürgen Habermas and some of his followers, and through the work of some Anglo-American thinkers like Josh Cohen and Amy Gutman and Dennis Thompson, the idea of deliberative democracy, right? The idea that what is wrong with actually existing democracies is that they are that they are, to too great a degree, about the push and pull of factional interests, about you know, strategic positioning, and they are insufficiently about the exchange of ideas, to put it very sort of baldly. To make them to a greater degree about the exchange of ideas, we should think about how to define an ideal of democratic deliberation aimed at not so much you know, the result being whoever has the strongest deck of, set of cards in a democratic debate ends up getting their way, you know, the powerful end up getting their way, but rather at consensus, where consensus is defined in the Habermasian mood as essentially the strength of the better argument, the unforced force of the better argument. Something like that. The unforced force of the better argument. Words to that effect on in the work of people like Gutman and Thompson. One of the animating ideas deliberative Democrats had was that essentially liberal Democrats in the Rawlsian Dworkinian mood had essentially divided up the labor between liberalism and democracy in the following way. We have robust constitutional guarantees that are enshrined in a constitution and a charter of rights. They decide the hard cases, courts decide the hard cases, and given that we have this protection, this form of principle, to use Dworkin's phrase, that is embodied in courts, it's okay if democracy is this slightly sort of normatively unattractive thing, which is just sort of interests pushing against one another, because since we have a robust charter of rights and process of judicial review attached to it, the messiness of democracy will not give rise to results that fall beyond the pale, since the sort of pale is being protected by judicial review and rights. So one of the motivations for the deliberative Democrats, on top of seeing this vision of democracy as being one that is excessively sort of pessimistic and dark, is also to say that in pluralistic societies such as ours, to think that a constitution or charter of rights will embody a set of neutral values that all can agree to in a highly pluralistic society is just a sort of vain hope. It is an inappropriate hope. We should agree that there's much more normatively up for grabs than can be than people like Dworkin had thought by placing their hope in judicial review and a charter of rights. We need to deliberate, therefore, about those things about which we reasonably disagree, rather than just expecting that they can flow out of, neutrally flow out of sort of judicial process. So my argument against deliberative Democrats has always had to do with the view that if we really take the idea that we are in a society marked by deep pluralism very seriously, the dichotomy of either it's just the balance of power that decides positions, or we have to arrive at consensus, is a kind of an artificially dichotomized choice. In that, and again, here this is a point at which looking and seeing at what goes on in the life of actually existing democracies kind of helps. Lost from this is what I've defined as the idea of a compromise, right? Where a compromise is defined, unlike a balance of power, as something which is arrived at through deliberative, some kind of deliberative process, but unlike a consensus, one in which we agree to something that we don't think is, all things considered, optimal, right? So we've all been through this experience in our day-to-day lives when you want to go to a restaurant with your partner or with a friend, and you want to do that more than you want to go to your particular restaurant, and you have to compromise in order to achieve that goal. In order to achieve the goal of going to a restaurant with your friend, you accept something that is suboptimal from the restaurant point of view in order to realize the value of agreeing to something that you can still live with to go to the restaurant with your friend. It seems to me that that category of compromise was absent from a lot of the literature about democratic theory, and it seems to me that we have to think both about what compromises are, how they differ from consensuses and from balance of powers, but especially where they are institutionally located. Where are the spaces and places in which democracy should instantiate, should promote compromise? So put that result to the side for just a minute. So I got involved in a debate with someone called Simon May, who people might know his writing, Simon Kebelea May.
Yeah, Florida.
Not Florida, yeah. Who wrote a number of papers in which, partly taking exception with me and others, he argued that the idea of compromise is democratically actually unappealing. For the following reason, So there are situations in which you have to compromise for purely strategic instrumental reasons. If we don't compromise with those crazy people, they'll start blowing up they'll start blowing up the abortion clinics, or they'll start blowing up, they'll commit violence. So there may be strategic instrumental reasons to engage in compromise. But in a democracy, if your party campaigns on a platform, say, of equal access to abortion for all, and they win, right? The victory absolves you of any need to compromise. Respect for democracy means respect for the results of democratic processes, which in this case will have meant that an issue will have been legitimately, if the democratic process has been carried out in ways that are according to, that haven't been rigged, to use a presently popular term. Respect for democracy actually requires something different from compromise, namely accepting the result of whatever democratic process has given rise to one party winning over another. So this is a little bit of a worry for me, because on the one hand, I do think that democracy, pluralistic democracy without compromise, is a problem, but I feel the force of, especially given my commitment to thinking about democracy not as a philosophy seminar, but about democracy as being realized through institutions that, for example, elections that give rise to certain parties winning and certain parties losing, that a party be elected on a platform and that it then be required of that party on the basis of some kind of ideal presented to it by political philosophy thinks that compromise is an important thing. Hey, you won, but you need to compromise now, might be seen as undemocratic rather than democratic. Even worse for me is the fact that in other writings of mine on issues around electoral reform, I've actually argued for positions that push in the same direction as the criticism that was made of my position by Simon. I'm going to summarize that a little bit. So I published a paper about a year ago at the invitation of a colleague from mine from the law faculty at McGill, Hoi Kong, who organized a conference on a topic which I'd never really thought about. It was a nice topic, which was, how can we change the electoral law or the norms governing elections in ways that will make elections more deliberative? Right, in ways that will make the electoral process more deliberative. Having gone through the last few weeks and months and years of the American electoral system, it's a question which deserves being posed, I think. And so, in the paper that I committed to this journal issue, I basically argued for the following thing. In order for electoral campaigns to be focused on issues rather than on sort of personalities, right? One way in which to do that is to incentivize the electorate by making electoral systems that have a better than even probability of electing governments that will be able to follow through on their electoral promises, right? In other words, if different parties present themselves to the electorate with different platforms, the election happens, there's a result, and then some feature of the electoral system makes it the case that it's actually difficult for the government that is formed as a result of the election to act on the promises that it made in the election, then that's not a very good incentive for the population that knows this in advance to debate about the issues. The likelihood that they will debate about personalities or about the character of the representatives that are suing for their votes, the incentive to do that heightens. And indeed, some people, like Burke, thought that that's what we ought to do. We ought to be electing people on the basis of our sense of their character rather than our sense of the issues. I argue that it's a less attractive view than having people actually deliberate about the issues. So I've argued that, in this paper, I've argued that one virtue of our system, which is much maligned for other reasons, notably its lack of representativeness, right? One of the virtues of our system is that precisely by exaggerating the plurality of votes that certain parties get and allowing them to constitute majorities in parliament, right? Creating majority governments is a way of taking away one of the reasons that a party might have to say, look, we got into power, but we can't carry through on our electoral platform because X. Now, compared to PR systems, where all things equal, coalitions have to happen after the election, right? So PR systems tend to generate electoral results in which no one party gets a majority of seats. After the election happens, they have to negotiate with people who have the requisite number of seats in parliament in order to form some kind of a working coalition, or at least a working arrangement. I was reading, I was just in Lithuania, and so for that reason, perhaps more interested in Lithuanian electoral politics these days than I might otherwise have been. And as you all probably know, the Farmers' Party, to everyone's surprise, has come out on top and is now negotiating a coalition with a bunch of other parties. Now, There are virtues to PR, in particular the fact that there's a closer representation between, a closer link between the proportion of votes that parties get and the number of seats that they command in Parliament. But one of the things that PR systems may do is take, as it were, the incentive for the population to debate about issues, to take that element away from them, because there's no guarantee that a party that controls the government and that has to, or that has the most seats and that has to coalesce with other parties in order to form the government, there's no guarantee that it will be able to follow through on its electoral promises. On the contrary, it will have usually very good reasons not to follow through on them. Namely, we would have done this, but for the fact that we had to compromise with the, you know, no property, you know, communists over here, and we, in order to get the working coalition, we had to get rid of this or that plank. And so, so I essentially argued for the importance of parties being able, right, to translate their electoral commitments into action once the election happens, as a condition for the electorate to be engaged in a way that would, all things equal, elicit more rather than less deliberation about the issues. If the compromise thing were to sort of be heaped upon them, that would provide them with another reason not to deliver on their electoral promises. We won the election, here was our platform, but Weinstock says that we have to compromise, and so we're going to do something different from what our electoral platform said we'd do in order to realize the values that are that accompany the practice of compromise. So my on the one hand, I've been arguing for the importance of compromise. On the other hand, there are these weighty democratic sort of reasons. Some of the arguments that I've presented myself in some of my writing to say that if compromise is to occur, it certainly shouldn't occur post-election. It certainly shouldn't be something that parties engage in after they've been elected, or at least all things equal, it should be something that parties engage in after they get elected. And so the proposal that I want to develop in the paper that I'm working on now is that we see parties themselves as sites of compromise. So back up a little bit, one of the properties that electoral systems that tend to create majorities, right, like our system does, right, it tends to, as we know, magnify, given certain distributional constraints, magnify shares of the vote as low as 35, 36, 37% into 60% of the seats in Parliament, right, one of the properties that has been observed all over the world of such systems is that they tend to promote what are referred to often as big tent parties, right? Parties that are, in effect, themselves coalitions. So you know, it's kind of understandable from a political incentives point of view. If you're an environmentalist in a proportional representation system, you can create an environmentalist party, a green party, if you have 10% of the vote. Even if it's spread across the population in a non-territorially concentrated way, you'll get 10% of representation in Parliament, which, you know, given the play of coalition politics, might be enough to actually give you quite a lot of power, perhaps even a disproportionate amount of power when comes the time to making a coalition. If you're an environmentalist under Ask Elizabeth May, if you're an environmentalist under First Past the Post, under a system such as ours, there's really no reason not to, I mean, you know, well, there are good reasons to decide that even if it means putting some water in my wine in terms of my positions, I would be better off going into, say, the Liberal Party, the New Democrats, or something like that, and trying to pull the position, the platform of that party in the direction that would embody my values and beliefs to a greater degree. The result, therefore, is that, in fact, parties created under first-past-the-post tend to be something like pre-electoral coalitions, right? They are not univocal, one principle vehicles. They are, in fact, united under some very vague and purposefully vague sort of normative commitments. What is the Liberal Party of Canada committed to? What is the Conservative Party of Canada committed to, really? Purposefully vague commitments, they are host to a number of factions that essentially vie against one another in pre-electoral contexts in order to create a platform which will at least to some degree reflect their interests. So one of the points that I'm making, and in a way, this is where I engage in the paper that I'm writing right now with Leah and Jonathan, that I disagree with, is their ideal of partisanship is much more the idea of being united around a cohesive kind of ideology. I think that their perhaps not a good example to give these days, but their ideal of a party is perhaps a certain vision of the British Labour Party, as it may have been instantiated at certain points in its history, which is not just a kind of congeries of a lot of people trying to hammer out a platform, but rather a body of which it is true to say that partisanship applies, right? That one is sort of committed to its ideals because its ideals are real, deep, substantive ideals, rather than being a congeries of a lot of different groups. So the claim that I'm making is that the way to get out of my quandary is to say that political parties under first past the post, amongst their virtues, are not just the fact that they create vehicles for effective governance and for citizens being able to say, well, having supported this party, I now view them as bound by the platform on the basis of which I have elected them, with no excuse being allowed to them on the basis of the fact that they've had to form a coalition with other parties. Another virtue is that we could see, and I think it would make sense to see, parties, electoral parties, as the sites within democratic systems of compromise. Compromise is not something that should be happening sort of post-election after the electorate has rendered a verdict. Rather, we should view political parties as the places in which the practice of compromise occurs. So the last thing that I'll say, it's about right, the last thing that I'll say, and this is something that I'd be, this is a paper that I haven't really started writing yet, it's still an idea about which I'd be interested in hearing whether people think that it has traction. One of the ideas around which I think that we need to do this kind of dual normative empirical work that Jonathan and Leah suggest that we do is around the idea of a platform, right? A platform is constituting a kind of a moral contract between citizens and a political party. A platform being a kind of a complete proposal made by a political party about how to govern the myriad issues that governments are appropriately tasked with governing, with a sense of how to negotiate trade-offs when all ideals are not mutually realizable. So, there's the moral responsibility, I want to argue, in this still notional paper of a political party, is to present to the electorate a deliberative object, an object upon which to deliberate, which is a kind of a complete, exhaustive set of proposals about how to deliver the various kinds of goods, services, regulations that governments are appropriately tasked with delivering, but a sense of how these kind of work together, and when they don't work together, how trade-offs are to be made. In other words, platforms are themselves, when they do respond to this requirement of being thorough, capacious, dealing with all of the issues that governments need to deal with, they will be themselves more likely the result of compromise, where different groups will bring to the table their view of how different issues will or won't be able to connect with one another. So there's a there are reasons internal to what I take to be a moral ideal that is constitutive of the contemporary ideal of the party, namely the idea that political parties are these things that create platforms which are then given over to the electorate to be debated over. There are reasons to do with this moral ideal as well, view political parties as the sites within which compromise in a democracy should occur. And another reason, again paradoxical and something where I started off debating about these things in a very different place from where I ended up. When I started thinking about electoral reform and parties, I thought clearly our system is terrible and needs to be junked in order to replace it with something more in the direction of proportional representation. I've come around to a very different view, which is that our system has virtues that we are at least well advised to think about before we reject them. And part of them have to do with the fact that they create these big tent parties that I think are more likely to give rise to compromise, and to compromises which are presented to the electorate to be debated over, rather than compromises that occur post-election to be debated over only by elites. So that's a big, messy picture of a lot of the things that I'm working on, some of them published, some of them in course, some of them still a kind of a glimmer in my mind's eye, but there's a lot of stuff to hopefully attack and have at. So thank you very much for any questions you might have.